the podcast starts.
Hello, dear listener. This is TD Velasquez, but as always, you can call me Dan, and welcome to the podcast on which we mostly talk about horror. Occasionally, we talk about other things, and often we swear. Now, there's been a little change to our planned schedule of episodes of late. I think you'll be aware if you've seen our Twitter posts or read our text on the podcast hosting site that we were hoping to do an episode about Midnight Mass in the near future. That's going to be postponed a little bit. The plan for this week was that Stella would join me to introduce the topic of today's episode, but Stella has very sadly had some bad news in the last week or so. I don't feel that it's my business to reveal it, but I do think it needs to be said that Stella's going to be stepping away from the podcast for a short time, and we will come to the Midnight Mass episode upon her return. In the meantime, though, you are going to be hearing her voice in this episode. We were originally going to be introducing this recording of a chat about Roman Polanski's 1968 horror classic, Rosemary's Baby. This was recorded nearly a year and a half ago. Unfortunately, the recording, which was a chat between myself, Stella, and Ian Winterton, was cut off before the ending. So we always intended to come back to it and finish it off, and we'd left it on the shelf. Given the current circumstances, we're pressing it into service, even though the conversation is broken off at the end. I will be back at the end, present day me, that is, to fill in the missing part of the conversation. Luckily, we had recorded pretty much the whole of the specific discussion about Rosemary's Baby when the recording was interrupted. We were going to go on to discuss the somewhat problematic and troubling nature of Roman Polanski's real-life misdeeds, and how this would affect our view of his work in general. But that's where the interruption happened, and that's where I'll come back in at the end. But for the most part, the discussion is a complete one. So just to segue into that recording, here is a clip from the movie. We usually play a trailer for the film, but the trailer for Rosemary's Baby is particularly visual and wouldn't work really with sound only. So instead we have this clip in which Rosemary Woodhouse, played by Mia Farrow, and her husband Guy, played by John Cassavetes, are hosting their friend Hutch, played by Morris Evans, in their new flat in the Bramford apartment building in New York City, and he tells them of the sinister history of the building. And this scene gives you an idea of the characters in the movie, but also a flavour of the kind of irreverent and subversive attitude that it takes to setting up horror film kind of cliches and then undercutting them and going in a different direction. Following this clip, you'll hear myself speak with writer and critic Ian Winterton and film and television historian and lecturer Dr. Stella Gaynor about Rosemary's Baby. But the first thing you'll hear is a little of composer Christoph Komeda's wonderfully distinctive and eerie theme music from the movie.
La 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 tried to write the management that you were drug addicts and litterbugs. Instead, I decided to lie and tell them you were wonderful, Terrence.
Ah, you're great, Hutch.
Wish I could talk you out of it, though.
He's pulling your leg, Ronnie.
Geez, I'm not.
Now, that looks great. That is.
Are you aware that the Bramford had rather an unpleasant reputation around the turn of the century? It's where the Trench sisters conducted their little dietary experiments. And Keith Kennedy held his parties. Adrian Mercado lived there, too. So did Pearl A.
Who were the Trench sisters?
Got it.
The Trench sisters were two proper Victorian ladies. They cooked and ate several young children, including a niece.
Oh, lovely.
Adrian Mercado practiced witchcraft. He made quite a splash in the 90s by announcing that he'd conjured up the living devil. Apparently people believed him, so they attacked and nearly killed him in the lobby of the Bramford.
You're joking.
Later, the Keith Kennedy business began, and by the 20s, the house was half empty.
I knew about Keith Kennedy. I didn't know that Mercado lived there.
And those sisters.
World War II filled the house up again.
Terrific.
What, the house?
The lamb.
They called it Black Bramford.
But hot. Awful things happen in every apartment house.
This house has a high incidence of unpleasant happenings. In 59... a dead infant was found, wrapped in newspaper in the basement.
You really rouse my appetite.
Have some more wine.
So, I'm here with Stella and Ian, and we've all just rewatched Rosemary's Baby for the first time in several years, 20-odd years in my case.
Yeah.
How about you, Stella?
I honestly couldn't put a figure on how long it's been that long. Maybe I've seen a bit of it when it's happened to have been on telly in the past, 10, 20 years, but when I last sat down and watched it as a full film, I honestly don't know. Really don't know. So 20 years plus, I reckon.
Right. Yeah. How about you, Ian?
Similarly, I'm wondering if I'd even seen it all the way through before. I guess I must have done, because I can't imagine sitting down and not finishing it. But I was probably at university when I was going through when you go through your watch everything that you're sort of told to watch by your film studies person.
Yeah.
And I maybe have seen it on and off on TV, but so probably 25 years.
Yeah.
So as I was saying off mic, it feels like I was almost watching it properly for the first time.
Yeah, to be honest.
Right.
I'd agree with that.
Lots of knowledge, like obviously loads of the shots and the plot. I knew all that off by heart.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like a completely virgin viewing of it. But in terms of me as a person, I don't think I've really watched it before.
Yeah, same. Right.
Because I don't remember really watching it and having a reaction like I've had a reaction now, nearly 50 years old, watching it.
Right.
When did you see it, Dan?
Funnily enough, I had a similar experience to you guys in that I couldn't remember hardly anything about the film, but I am fairly specific. I think I saw it in 98. Certainly during the time that we were at Sixth Form College, which was 97 to 99.
Yeah.
And there was one bit of it that felt kind of very familiar, recognisably so, which is where Rosemary says, "This is no dream, this is really happening."
Yeah.
But yeah. I think that clip has appeared in horror films that I've seen more recently. Like,
also, that's the clip that gets shown a lot on like Mark Kermode. When you're watching documentaries about great horror movies, that's kind of because that's a line that's loaded.
Yeah.
This is no dream. That speaks about the movie
It's that clip that's always shown, and the one where she walks into the room and she's got the knife in her hand, and everyone turns around to stop, and the camera's behind her. That's the other one that's always shown in commode-esque type things, isn't it?
Wow.
So yeah, loads of it was really familiar when I watched it yesterday and today. I watched it in two halves, but loads of it still felt really new. There's just so many things that I just didn't see when I watched it the first time. When I did watch it the first time, I was a kid, probably too young to be watching it. I would imagine under 10, 9, 10 years old that I watched it.
Oh, wow.
Yes. So, you know, thanks, Mum. And I remember the devil stuff and the, you know, the poison baby stuff and Rosemary feeling sick throughout her pregnancy, and I remember her pain, and I remember her being all right with the devil baby at the end. But that's it. I just saw all the devil baby stuff. I didn't see any of the other surrounding gender politics or religious stuff that just passed me by when I was a kid, which is, you know, understandable. I was a kid.
Well, as far as I can tell, it passed me by when I was 19.
So. Which is why watching it again these last couple of days, it's definitely felt, you know, almost like a new film again. So it's been enjoyable to watch it back.
It's a brilliant film, isn't it? I know this is almost, it's one of those films that really is fresh and fast, even though it's a slow burn.
Mm.
It's actually a really slick, fast watch, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, apart from a couple of details, which I think we'll come to, I can't think of much in it that felt like it wasn't necessary. You know, it's everything feels contributing to the overall build, although there are a couple of odd moments. But, Ian, you suggested we watch this, so let's start the conversation off with you. What was it that made you want to suggest us watch this film? Is it because you kind of half remembered watching it a long time ago and just wanted to go back to it?
I guess, like, one of the best things about watching this, about doing this podcast, is genuinely watching stuff. And Rosemary's Baby is one of those ones that I've technically watched it and I could probably have talked about it before, but I've never, like we were just saying, it's almost like I haven't seen it because I'm a totally different person to the person that did watch it, and I probably wasn't paying attention. Probably just had my main memories of it are of the rape scene and the sort of general montage of that, the sort of horror of that. And obviously I've got no awareness of whether I was, you know, picking up on any sexism any of the other things we're going to discuss. I don't think I was analysing it in any way whenever I did watch it. So it's almost like I might as well not have watched it because now it's such a rich film, isn't it? Like it's got so much in it. And not just because of its legacy. It's almost like the only negative things about it are because of its legacy. Because maybe it seems a bit hokey now. Like occasion, you know, the devil seems a little bit like a spent force in the movies, which is exactly why I remember Ari Aster when he was talking about Hereditary, which is definitely something that's got Rosemary's Baby's DNA in it.
Yeah.
Big time. Is one of the things he did was, well, we can't make it the devil because everyone laughs at the devil. People saying Hail Satan now that's the only bit that seemed a bit dated. But I was totally with the film anyway. But when they're going, Hail Satan, it seems a bit funny, doesn't it? Because we've had The Exorcist and The Omen and God knows what else. And then, you know, and then the scary movie films we've had, you know.
But I don't know, though. I still found it chilling. Maybe this is my kind of
background. I totally found it chilling because I was swept along with it. But I'm just saying that's the only bit that made it a bit dated because it started... It must have been so powerful in 1968.
God, yeah.
So powerful. Yeah. Because, you know, even by 1974, they were still, you know, the Exorcist still scared the Jesus out of people because they believed in the devil.
Yeah.
And now, like we've said many times, nowadays young audiences tend to laugh at the Exorcist. And I imagine they'd laugh at Hail Satan. Silly people.
I don't know. Maybe I'll just try saying it every now and then and see if people laugh.
Yeah. I think it's probably in context. Hail Satan! if you're in Tesco.
That's the thing, though. Hail Satan is the end of the movie. And I think by then, even though the characters of the Castavets are eccentric, annoying people, and there are a bunch of characters in it who are a little bit out of the ordinary and you don't like them, they do all seem very real and human. Like my favourite character, who is Patsy King as Laura Louise, the woman who comes and just spontaneously starts knitting in Rosemary's
just sits
apartment.
Down and starts knitting.
You know, she's there at the end and she's completely with the whole Hail Satan stuff, but she's also sticking her tongue out at Rosemary and just kind of being an annoying busybody. They all seem very human and therefore that of that kind of fervency that they all show at the end.
Well, I mean, at some point, well, I guess are we talking about it now, but the banality of evil, because the Holocaust is, you know, Polanski's experience of the Holocaust is run through most of his films. And you can see, and this film, it's sort of post-Holocaust. And there's a quote I read today, which was, a lot of it was, he saw a lot of pregnant women being bundled onto trucks, you know, during the Holocaust by big men in uniform. And so that fear of seeing, you know, someone as waif-like as Rosemary being marched about by big men with needles.
Yeah.
It's kind of a Holocaust nightmare in some ways. It's, you know, it can be read on lots of different levels, but one of the things was, you know, he's always, a lot of his stuff has, you know, has men in power marching civilians about, and women and children.
That explains the haircut as well, doesn't it? Rosemary's otherwise inexplicable haircut in the middle of the film. It just makes her into that image.
Well, it is genuinely, it's genuinely a sort of cool pixie cut from the time. But at the same time, there's a line that's in the novel that he cut out that Polanski had in his script and then decided not to do, which is where one of her Gentile friends, you know, one of her actual friends, not from the satanic cult, went during that bit where they come in and they're all worrying about how unhealthy she looks. They say you look like Miss Concentration Camp 1966. So, but he decided to take that line out probably because it was a little bit on the nose.
To
you know, so like you say, that referencing it, she's skinny, she's got the short hair, but then to actually say concentration camp was probably too much.
Sure.
Too on the nose. So it was in the book, but they took it out. He took it out.
Should mention this. Have you read the book, Ian?
No, I haven't. No.
Neither have I. Stella?
No.
Just because it's important to recognise that it is based on the 1967 book by Ira Levin. Normally, we at least one of us would try and read the book of the film that we're talking about. But, you know, this was arranged in quite a hurry this session, wasn't it?
Yeah. I've read Stepford Wives, if that helps.
All right, so you have read some Ira Levin.
Yes, I've read Stepford Wives.
Yeah, okay. from what I've read about Rosemary's Baby, is it was optioned before it was published. Like, the galleys of it went round Hollywood. And Polanski snapped it up. So I think it's probably very close to what we see on screen.
Mm. Was it Polanski or William Castle, do you know, who snapped it up?
I do not know.
But, I think it's a really bizarre partnership that this movie is produced by William Castle, who is a famous kind of American schlockmeister, directed and produced films like The Tingler and House on Haunted Hill. But, you know, then it's written and directed by Polanski. So I just wonder who kind of originated that idea. And I have to admit, I did do some Googling, but I've not been able to answer that question. Although I am on Wikipedia, so I'll just have a quick look to see if that tells us.
But Polanski, but the sort of themes of it, it being written by a Jewish American, and you know, and then made by a Polish Jewish, American French, whoever will have him these days, by Polanski. So the sort of Judaism is a very important part of the book and the film, in a way that maybe you wouldn't see, and I certainly have never had the thought before watching it this time around. But it's all about anti-Semitism and there's lots of little bits of anti-Semitic stuff from Rosemary is quite anti-Semitic in a sort of innocent kind of way, casual kind of way.
This stuff kind of went completely over my head, I have to say, even viewing it this time. So, could you talk a bit more about that, please, Ian?
Well, it's just it's almost like they went for blood libel, which is the whole, obviously, the whole medieval and well, googling this, I found posts on Stormfront, you know, the neo-Nazi American site, discussing Rosemary's Baby, because it's been wrapped up in the QAnon, the QAnon the anti-Semitic nonsense. They're taking the piss out of us. They're hiding in plain sight, kind of nonsense. But the fact is, the idea is that the blood libel, which is that Jews use Christian children and mix their blood with their flour to make their bread. It's just ridiculous people would even believe it, but it's fed into Pizzagate and QAnon and the mole children and all those sort of ridiculous things. People are still believing it now. And I'd argue that they were having Ira Levin and then Polanski sort of almost in tandem, because it's almost like book and film came out simultaneously kind of thing. They're using the prejudices of Gentile culture, WASP America. Well, no, it's not WASP in this case, is it? Because it's Catholic. Anyway, mainstream Christian America. They're using their prejudices against them, because it's almost like, what if Jews did come and want your babies? It's kind of that thing, and it's almost like, near the end, it's almost like her madness is seen as madness, because it's when she mentions the Dr. Saperstein, and she mentions him being part of it, and you can't tell, and then you have Dr. Hill, and you think he's on her side, but actually what he's done is done, oh my God, she's an anti-Semitic nut.
Right.
And so it kind of uses it all. It's a very uncomfortable film for many reasons, and this is one of them. But it kind of uses that anti-Semitic prejudice sort of in a feedback loop against Rosemary standing in for her culture, which is why, because before I watched this, I was a bit worried. Oh, can you have a heroine who loses at the end in this age of Me Too? Won't it seem too horrible or too misogynistic? And I don't think it does at all. And one of the reasons for me is because she's an innocent, and actually she's being killed because of the sins of her culture, which is the Catholic faith in particular and general American Christianity, sort of in the whole, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, sure. And also, I mean, she's not actually killed, though, is she? She's
So she's not killed, but she's defeated. She's utterly defeated.
She succumbs, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Although
it's not a good ending for her.
No,
but it's quite an empowering ending in a way, because she has got two really bad choices at the end, but at least she has the choice, and she could either stay with her son and try and raise the son of Satan with the Satanists, or she could go back to Guy, who she knows is a horrible swine.
Yeah.
Who sold her out just for the sake of his own career. And she does make the choice. You know, her agency is not entirely taken away from her. And you know, I think there's a slight sense of hope at the end. You know, what will happen over the years as Rosemary is there, as Adrian is being raised. By the way, there is a sequel to this movie that was made 8 years later. It's a TV movie called Whatever Happened to Rosemary's Baby, and Ruth Gordon does reprise her role as Minnie Castevet in it.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it. Nobody talks about it.
There's also a sequel that Ira Levin wrote in the late 90s called Rosemary's Son. And right. I've not read it, but the plot, the plot outline sounds awful. But she ends up getting dragged to hell. She awakes from a coma, and Adrian is a grown-up, and he says he's got powers, but he's not the Antichrist, and he's running a charity. And then it turns out he's lying, and then as she's confronting him, Satan appears and drags her to hell. And then she wakes up, and it's the 60s, before Rosemary's Baby happened, and so... I've not read it, obviously, but then apparently it then suggests maybe she did get dragged to hell and she's now in purgatory. But it also brings in sort of stuff to do with John Lennon and things like that, which is reminds me of why Exorcist 3, some of the problems I had with Exorcist 3, when the author gets hung up on
the reaction to the original
that's accrued around this thing they wrote in sort of innocence, you know, a bit like his three, he got off on the Zodiac killer. It seems like he's getting off on the fact that some people have said, because Mia Farrow was at the Maharishi's place and allegedly got sexually assaulted by the Maharishi, which is why Lennon and Harrison left in disgust. And then he took a place at the Dakota buildings with Yoko Ono, which is where they shot Rosemary's Baby. So they always say the place where they used to say that's where they shot Rosemary's Baby is now. That's the place where they shot John Lennon.
Jeez.
So there's all these stupid conspiracy theories and you know, like it's a cursed film, and part of it's the Maharishi putting a curse on John Lennon. Through Rosemary's Baby or something, I'm not entirely sure, but yeah, but the fact that an author would then add to that himself, just like with Exodus 3, it just leaves a bad taste in my mouth personally.
I think that's fair enough.
But in terms of this movie, I think it's an amazing movie.
It is. Stella, do you want to talk a bit about what you saw in it this time as opposed to your initial viewing so many years ago?
Well, I mean, just to agree with Ian's last point, it's an incredible movie, and it was, well, I was going to say it was a joy to watch, but it's absolutely not a joy to watch. It's a deeply uncomfortable film. But I found it uncomfortable for different reasons. So, like I said before, when I saw it as a kid, I just saw the devil baby stuff, and I knew that she'd been raped, but I don't think I knew what rape was. So I knew it was bad and it was grim, and that she was supposed to have been asleep through it all, but she came to because she didn't eat all the mousse. So I knew all that was bad, and I knew the pregnancy was making her sick, and because it was, you know, she was pregnant with the devil's baby. So I saw all of that when I was a kid. And then watching it yesterday and today, there was just various points that I picked up on, maybe because I'm grown up, supposed to be grown up now, and because I've been through pregnancy, because I'm a mother. I just saw loads of the stuff that caught up from Rosemary's point of view as a woman and as a pregnant woman and as a stay-at-home wife as well. I found all of that deeply troubling. So, for instance, right near the start of the film, when they first move into the apartment and they've got no furniture and they're just sat on the floor, and she just says, "Hey, let's make love," and then they do, and she's instigated the sex, and it's very, very sweet, like it's very, very loving. The camera goes a bit porn film for a few seconds.
I did think that was a really weird moment though, because she just says that, and then
she just says that she opens a drink and then says, "Hey, let's make love," and it's like, "We'll drink your beer first."
And they then they don't embrace or anything. They both very formally
get
undressed separately.
Well, you know, let's not mess about. Let's just get down to business. But she instigates it, and it is quite loving. And you know, they're clearly they have a laugh during it. Like he makes a joke about something, and they start laughing. And
it's not quite "Don't Look Now," though, is it?
Yeah. But she instigates the sex, and it's quite And it's nice. It's clearly enjoyable for the pair of them. And then the other time that she's involved in sex, it's when Guy has instigated it via, you know, the sedating her and via the devil worshippers. And then it's very, very violent. So I was seeing the difference between the sex that a woman might want and then the sex that the man was agreeing to. And then when she comes around in the morning and she thinks that Guy had sex with her anyway while she was passed out, which essentially she thinks that Guy's raped her because it was non-consensual. She's covered in scratches and she's clearly uncomfortable with it, but she just lets it go. Like, she doesn't mention it again. She just sits on the side of the bed and looks a bit uncomfortable. And what I couldn't sort of stop thinking about for a few minutes while watching the film, it was like, was rape in marriage still allowed then?
Oh, perhaps? Totally.
And it's just...
I'd like to look at the exact dates, but all I know is 1992 was when it was outlawed in Italy.
Right.
And that was one of the last places. So I bet you America was the bloody 80s.
It was still okay.
I mean, that's what really shocked me, that bit, that I didn't want to miss baby night.
Yeah, that he just did it to her. He said to her, I didn't want to miss baby night. So he knows what's actually happened the night before, and that she's been raped by the devil. She's covered in scratches. But he says to her, hey, I didn't want to miss baby night. And, you know, maybe I got a little bit rough. And she's just like, oh, okay. And just lets that kind of go. And I was like, wow, you know, fucking hell, that was the times. That's terrifying.
No, funnily enough, that's one of the one details that I remembered from my initial viewing of it in 1998, the way he jokily justifies what he's done by saying, quote, it was kind of nice in a necrophile way.
Yeah, it's like, God. I knew when I watched it when I was younger that he'd told that lie. But the lie that he tells is also so despicable. Yeah. He's telling her, I raped you last night. Never mind. What?
He just says it with a blithe grin, like it's just one of those things.
Yeah, that really stuck in me.
Yeah, that was the moment when I sort of thought, like, it was a real moment. I was going, is this where it's going to seem dated? Like, how much is that intentional? How much is that supposed to be shocking? And you know, you can watch some movies and they have an unintentional meaning, or they cast unintentional light on the times they're made in.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if it's that one of those moments, like how big was that moment to an audience
to the viewers then
creators 50 years ago?
Yeah.
Or was that perfectly acceptable? Well, not acceptable, but was that just one of those things that men did because you were married to them?
Because you were married and ownership.
You're married.
Yeah.
It's like my talking to pregnancy, but when you talk about sex, when you start having sex after pregnancy,
as a
couple, and my mother was telling me about how awful things were, you know, the awful things they'd say, but female nurses would say, well, you'll probably be raped by your husband after 6 weeks. So best to let him. And things like that. So just the way they'd blithely say your husband will rape you because
just expected to happen.
That was in the early 70s. Mm. So did you think that her, because she's in meek mode at that point, she's a simpering meek person. And that's what I was sort of troubled by to start with. And then I'm not, because she goes on a journey.
Yeah, she gets stronger, doesn't she?
She, even though she's defeated, she's very, very strong by the end.
Yeah, and she's on a mission. You know, all the times that she tries to escape, and she, you know, she's very thoughtful about how she tries to escape and get out of there. But then you mentioned before about Dr. Hill not believing her, and that kind of did strike a chord. And I think it does still make it a relevant movie now, because we're having much wider cultural discussions about people not believing the victim, and to immediately, you know, just to shun what people have said, or victims being afraid of speaking up in case they're not being believed. And Rosemary does try to speak up on more than one occasion, and she's repeatedly not believed. And I think
it's a really powerful moment, because the whole thing is all of them witches, and he's not in the cult. But he is in the cult of the patriarchy.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So it's almost like all of them witches goes wider. It's you know, if you're a woman, then you know, Dr. Hill will side with Dr. Saperstein.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's quite in the boys' club.
One of the reasons she is a powerful kind of lead, I think, is because becomes clear fairly early, in the earlier than I thought it would, actually, because I kind of remember that the storyline is there, you know, she's in a big kind of satanic conspiracy, but she doesn't realise it until the end. But actually, she does realise it quite... I mean, the audience knows it quite quickly because we see the ceremony and the rape and all that. But she catches on quite soon. The thing is, there is nobody on her side, and that kind of becomes clear. She knows.
She's so alone.
I also misremembered that. I thought maybe she knew there was something wrong, but she didn't realise her husband was in on it till the end of the film. But she knows. I mean, that's almost the first thing, is she realises how strange he's behaving.
So. Well, there's that point where when the pain stops and she says, "Oh, now I can feel it kicking," and he won't touch it because he knows, he won't touch her tummy
because
he knows what's in there. And I'm sat there going, "Oh, you bastard!"
That's one of the sort of another amazing moment when she goes, "It's alive!
It's alive!"
And it's like
and he's frightened,
thinking,
isn't he?
You're thinking Frankenstein.
Mm. Yeah.
Frankenstein's monster. But also she seems... It's like the joy of pregnancy in reverse, wasn't it? Because... because pregnancy is a time, you know, the glowing and the... You know, lots of people will say it's one of the nicest feelings, apparently. I don't know if you'd agree, Stella.
Once I stopped feeling queasy, did actually very much enjoy being pregnant.
Yeah, most people will say that, you know, most women will say like feeling pregnant does feel amazing, you know.
Yeah, because it's mental.
Your body gets pumped full of lovely endorphins, and you're growing a life and all the rest of it. Mm. And this was almost like the opposite. She wasn't glowing. She was turning into a zombie. She was getting skinnier while the thing was... It was just... The makeup was just amazing. It's like
this thing eating away
at her. So she's getting so unhealthy because this demon thing is...
She's so beautiful as well, isn't she? The amount of times that I thought watching it, it was just like, how beautiful she is. Even when she's looking gaunt and pale, she's like...
Well, yeah. She's got heroin cheek before heroin cheek, hasn't she?
So gorgeous.
That moment of the film was one of the bits which I didn't quite get, is that she kind of, you know, she is complaining of pains and she is wasting away and she is resisting Minnie's moose. Oh, and I need to mention this. I was so pleased that I finally understood after many years a chapter title from Kim Newman's book Nightmare Movies. The chapter is called Devil Movies or... If the moose tastes chalky, don't eat it.
Don't eat it.
So Rosemary's kind of like, no, I'm not having any more of that. I'm not having the yogurt. Sorry, yeah, it's the kind of health yogurt drinks that Minnie makes for her.
Yeah.
And then suddenly there's that scene where she goes, the pain stopped and it's alive and I can feel him kicking. And then she's okay for a bit and then it starts hurting again. And I thought they were going to explain what that meant. Maybe they did and I missed it. What do you guys think happened there?
I think she's just kind of overwhelmed with not feeling the pain anymore because she so wants to be pregnant and then she is and then it feels awful and then she gets some respite. And I think it's kind of, you know, and it's what happens at the end. Does her mothering instinct take over or does she make the choice? But I think it's the overwhelmingness of her being pregnant.
Yeah, I would understand that reading of it. It was just that I didn't understand why the pain then came back. She did eat. She started eating the yogurts, the health drinks.
Maybe it was
drinking them.
What's it called? Braxton Hicks.
Sorry, Stella.
Maybe she was getting Braxton Hicks contractions. So they're like your body's like practice ones that you get in the last few weeks, and they are sharp and they are mean, and you think something's happening, but absolutely nothing is happening. It's just your body going, ah, let's practice these muscles. And then nothing's happening. And then you ring the doctor and they go, shut up, you're fine. Just wait for a bit.
Yeah.
But it really hurt. Yeah, it will. Good luck with that.
She's not growing a normal child in there either, is she? So she's, you know, you never really see the baby, do you? Well, you never see the baby.
Because when the baby's in the big black beautiful cot thing at the end, which to be fair I loved, I would have loved my kid in one of them. one of the minions says, "Look at his feet." So is it suggesting he's got cloven hooves? So if that's kicking inside her, I would imagine that's deeply uncomfortable.
Oh yeah, no, I can understand that as well. I just thought it was a strange kind of repeated plot beat that she, on two occasions she goes, "I'm sick of this. I'm not having any more of Minnie's health drinks. This has all got to stop." And then she's okay with it for a bit, and then she says, "I'm sick of this. He's got to stop again."
Estrogen, I reckon. She gets a big wave of it. It makes you feel good.
Yeah.
Okay. That'll be an explanation then. Okay.
Yeah.
Ian, what else have you got to say?
Well, I guess we could go on about the fact that he's made the without saying that they're Jewish, he's made the Satanist quite Jewish, even though it's a bit confusing because one of the things she doesn't think Dr. Saperstein is in the cult because he's Jewish. But nearly all the actors he gets to play, like Mr. Shand is a Jewish actor. Tony Curtis is the guy on the other end of the phone. He's a Jewish actor. There's Ruth Gordon's character is a stereotypical Jewish mother type thing. And also they're deliberately, it's almost like they're getting the ugly stereotypes about their own people, and they're kind of weirdly reclaiming them by showing them like the whole thing about there's a stereotype about Jewish, especially elderly Jewish women, being really disgusting eaters. And that we've got that with Minnie. She's a stereotype, but it's like Jewish filmmakers have made them stereotypes on purpose. And then you get Rosemary being a little bit anti-Semitic by going, she talks about the price, she asks the price of everything. So there's all these little things, and I think it's a really uncomfortable, deliberately uncomfortable feedback loop of and then the way that the Catholicism is shown in the dream sequences is very important. They're not there by accident. She's not a Catholic by accident. Satan triumphs because Christianity is anti-Semitic and subdues its women. So in the sort of flashback / dream sequences, you see how she's sort of been groomed by the Catholic, by her Catholic upbringing, to be meek, to cry, to be the sort of simpering person. All she wants is a baby at the beginning. That's why Satan triumphs, because that society as a whole is ill. Like they mock, there's a whole bit where they're mocking Catholicism and saying it's showbiz and it's rubbish, and they slag off the Pope. But it's almost like that's the bit, that's that tension. And it reminded me of The Wicker Man. The way that The Wicker Man, the villains have a point. The villains are the pagans, and the pagan religion looks more attractive for all the horrors it's doing. It's almost like, and that's a Catholic man as well, who ultimately is rigid, stupid, you know. So ultimately, it's a sort of criticism against the society that that he represents, and in a way, Rosemary's defeat is a sort of criticism of, you know, we're responsible for our own doom kind of thing.
I mean, I believe that in The Wicker Man Sergeant Harry's meant to be a Calvinist, but as I'm not very clear on the difference between Calvinism and Catholicism, you know.
Quite a lot of different statements.
I am certainly a Catholic anyway, and I still got the point from it. But, you know, The Wicker Man skewered my faith. So, and probably because I love The Wicker Man so much is one of the reasons I've never... It's a little known fact, Stella. That's true. It's probably one of the reasons I've not come back to Rosemary's Baby before, because I kind of felt like I've got my kind of anti-Catholic complex multi-layered movie. But you know, I am really glad that I've come back and looked at this again.
Yeah, me too.
Because The Wicker Man doesn't have a complex and ambivalent attitude to anti-Semitism.
No, that's it. It's a whole different layer. Yeah, that I've not thought about before.
There's another line as well, which another line, which is when they're talking about the building, and they it was empty, and then World War II soon filled it up, and that's that's basically part of that whole here come all the Jews, because it's World War II filling up that part of New York kind of thing. So that's another. That's another sort of anti-Semitic kind of thing that's sort of uttered.
There's loads of little details. I feel like I was noticing all the wrong ones. But for instance, in the Catholic dream sequences that you were just talking about, Ian, is John F. Kennedy supposed to be one of the people on the boat?
I think so, because it's very much set when it's made as well, because, you know, he says, get me to Kennedy Airport, and it's literally only just been called Kennedy Airport. Mm. And obviously one reason he was a controversial president was because he was Catholic. So that's sort of all mixed up with the whole...
Because you don't see his face, but you hear his voice, and I just thought, that actor's doing a John F. Kennedy impression, isn't he? But, you know, that all fits. While we're on random sort of cameos, I was a bit bamboozled by the whole Victoria Vetri thing. Did that strike either of you at all? The character played by an actress credited as, I'll just look it up, Angela Dorian Terry.
The girl in the washroom basement,
Rosemary makes friends with her in the laundry room, and she says, she's looking at her, and Terry says, why are you looking at me like that? And she said, oh, I'm sorry, I thought you were Victoria Vetri, the actress. And she goes, oh, I'm always mistaken for her. I don't see the resemblance. And it is Victoria Vetri, the actress, credited under a different name, playing that part. But Victoria Vetri was not that famous. I mean,
is this Victoria Vetri from Star Trek?
No, she was never in Star Trek. There is another model in Star Trek who is mistaken for Victoria Vetri.
Oh, I'm getting really mixed up there.
So it's like, I feel like it's like a massive in joke. In the universe of the film, you could justify it by saying, you know, Rosemary's married to an actor. She probably watches a lot of TV. And she might have met a lot of actors, and she knew. But it's not like the people in the audience would know who Victoria Vetri was. She is in a Hammer film called When Dinosaurs Ruled the Earth, which was made after this. And that's about it. But because I knew she that was... name, I just, that line just really threw me. And then to realise, it was her.
I'm looking at her IMDb now, and she was in Wagon Train. But then I can't see anything that she was in for more than a few episodes. So, i.e., she was a jobbing actor.
Yeah, it's just a really strange joke. But anyway, you know, that was just something I thought I wanted to mention. It's not remotely connected to the serious themes of the film, unless it is.
Yeah.
We need to watch it again.
Well, I think in the universe of the film, I guess it's just, yeah, it's a bit weird.
Well, no, in the universe of the film, she knows actors and she knows TV. Yeah. You know, she's in that world, so she will, you know, she'll recognise people and she'll know people. So I think it's fine. But I just think it's a weird joke to contrive.
But it's also, if they were sort of saying, it's a bit weird. Because if she recognises someone who's like, you know, a jobbing actor, that's fair enough, she recognises her. But the person who is being recognised will go, who?
Exactly.
You know, they won't go, oh, that happens all the time, like she does in the film. It's sort of saying, you look like Marilyn Monroe.
I'd like to know that bit is in the book.
Yeah, it's very strange, isn't it?
Listeners, let us know.
Other random moments that I just picked up on that I thought were kind of... How would you say... I'm looking at my notes and I'm kind of... conscious that I've just noticed little incongruous things rather than the kind of deeper themes, but I did write down Japanese camera guy.
Yeah.
A little bit racist.
but I guess that plays into the use of stereotypes to kind of disguise Satanism. You know, it works with what you're saying about the presentation of the Jewish characters, which hadn't occurred to me.
Yeah, well, I think it's also because one thing you don't really realise till you read about it afterwards is that it's a global conspiracy. So it really is like QAnon. It's to sort of go, you know, he's a Japanese guy. And, oh my God, she's the mother. You know, this is the Antichrist and the global cabal of Satanists. Have all gathered in New York for this. You know, this is year one of Satan has triumphed. This is year one of the Antichrist. So it's not just like a minor thing. We've had a baby in our little, tiny little cult. It's like the global satanic conspiracy has now got their Antichrist. I mean, it's kind of like a prequel to The Omen or something, which obviously The Omen
we should talk about that one time.
I'd love to do that.
I love The Omen. Nah. Yeah, but the Omen obviously is very much, you know, out of The Exorcist and Rosemary's Baby.
Oh yeah, they are the Trinity, aren't they? Of kind of satanic movies. But I do think that The Omen is like it's Rosemary's Baby, but with Rosemary herself stripped out of it. Because in The Omen, I remember thinking, it's very strange from a scripting point of view that the wife doesn't get much to do and say, because in The Omen, it's her husband's betraying her for you know, he's a well-intentioned character, unlike Guy in Rosemary's Baby, but because he betrays her by lying to her and say, he doesn't tell her that her baby died and he swaps the baby for another.
Yeah.
And the script doesn't pay attention to that character, so she never realizes that her husband betrayed her. And I remember thinking that would have been a really interesting emotional dynamic to the film. Why didn't they concentrate on that? But then I realized, well, that would make it Rosemary's Baby, essentially. You know, it would look like a less good version of Rosemary's Baby.
She'd have to make the same choice, wouldn't she?
Except Damien hadn't come from her body.
Yeah, but she didn't know that.
No. But what I mean is,
either way, it's a betrayal.
If she found out the truth, she'd be like, "Well, fuck you, other kid."
But if she'd looked after him already for a few years, then she might already be attached.
Yeah, that's true as well. He was older, wasn't he?
Yeah.
But it's that.
Yeah, yeah.
The complexity in the kind of husband-wife relationship that would engender would have been really interesting, but. Anyway, they chose not to do that. Instead, they chose to have Gregory Peck be kind of
heroic.
Utterly virtuous. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, because he regrets what he did, ultimately, and he did do it for
takes
sort of
him a bloody
reasons.
While, though.
Yeah, well, and the wife has to die to get into that.
She has to
point.
Die. That priest has to die. The fellow with the, you know, the takes a while for him to show any regret. He's just, it seems to me that we're not talking about that film. We'll save that for when we're talking about.
He's an American politician.
Good point.
But you, his counterpart in Rosemary's Baby is worth talking about, because the amazing Cassavetes as a truly awful husband.
What a bastard.
Well, yeah. One of the things I wrote down was that right from the very start of the film, he's telling lies, like from his first... Stella's holding a piece of paper with a rude message on it about Guy, which we cannot possibly say.
I can't say it. Begins with a C.
Off mic.
But, but yeah, you know, when they walk into the building at the start to look at the apartment... The first two lines that come out of Guy's mouth are lies. The guy says, the man showing them the apartment says, "What do you do for a living?" And he says, "I'm a doctor." And then, and Rosemary has to say, "No, he isn't. He's an actor." And then the man says, "Oh, what have you been in?" And he says, "Oh, I've been in Hamlet or something." And he cites some highfalutin things.
Yeah,
and Rosemary just goes, "No, he's done a lot of TV and some commercials."
Well, that's what's brilliant about his character is. I mean, obviously, as a real person, he's awful, but as a character, he's amazing, because he is such a vainglorious, like he's very easily seduced, and you believe that. He's a struggling actor with a massive ego, and all it takes is for the old guy to go, "Oh, that bit you did in Lufa, were you really not the main part?" And straight away he's sort of going, what if we just did a little ritual and made Tony Curtis blind, and you can take that part. So it's all kind of weirdly mixed up with the sort of theatre world as well, which probably plays to stereotypes about sort of deviant theatre types as well. They're all depraved in the theatre.
It's true.
Yes.
If it's going to be Satanists in New York, it'll be Jewish people working in the theatre.
Excuse me.
No, he's terrific.
Yeah, but John Cassavetes is just an amazing individual who's, I guess he's quite well known to film buffs, but he's not very well known to the wider world. He was quite well known in the 60s. Because he's so swoonsome, but have you ever seen Murder of a Chinese Bookie? He did a lot of neo noir. I mean, he did some amazing films, but is that one of the films he directed? Yeah, films he directed.
I've never seen any films he directed. I'd really love to see the movie Gloria that he made with his wife Gina Rowlands.
Yeah, I've seen that. But Murder of a Chinese Bookie, I would recommend to people who want to have a non-horror recommendation.
But he
famously saw acting as very much his secondary job. He was all about directing, and acting was to pay the bills and put into his films.
Apparently, I think I read somewhere that Polanski didn't really like working with him because, as an actor who was also a director, Cassavetes would have his own ideas about how certain scenes should be acted and shot, and Polanski had to do a lot of work to go, "No, just do it the way I want you to do it." Okay.
Yeah, it seems weird now because Polanski's sort of one of the big names in directing, isn't he? It's like, just have an argument with Stanley Kubrick about directing, kind of thing.
Yeah. Well, this was his first American film, wasn't it? So he did have a few films behind him, but he was... And by the way, I brought up the question earlier about whether Castle or Polanski had the rights to Rosemary's Baby. Apparently, and I got this off Wikipedia, folks, so take this for what it's worth. Apparently, Castle approached Robert Evans, who gets a thank you credit on the movie. He's the producer who later did Chinatown with Polanski. Evans bought the rights to Rosemary's Baby on the advice of Castle, but he was only given the option on condition that Castle, who was known for kind of horrible B movies or cheapo B movies, would not direct it. So that's why it ends up being a William Castle production, directed and written by someone else. And I suppose it was Evans then who would have made the link to Polanski.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing we haven't touched upon is, as we go into the final straight, is the whole Me Too era and Polanski as a person. And that this is... I mean, because it comes from Ira Levin's book as well, and he's obviously one of his themes, you know, with Stepford Wives and things, is he's aware of tyranny of domesticity for women in that era. So he's obviously, Ira Levin is obviously sort of quite right on for his era. But this is a film made by Polanski. And then it's tied in with, again, we were talking about John Lennon getting shot, but also it's tied in with, you know, the Manson, the whole White Album thing was made. Sexy Sadie was written, and that led to the White Album, which led to Charles Manson going on his family going on a killing spree, which then killed Polanski's. This is not what happened. This is what people believe. But then the fact that people are endlessly fascinated, but then it was Polanski's
wife
pregnant wife who was one of the victims. So this is the, you know, this...
Well, I suppose what we're tackling is the fact that this is a film about abuse made by a man who was convicted years later of abuse, wasn't it? He was
11 years later.
He
admitted raping an underage girl and had to flee America to avoid the jail time, and other allegations have surfaced since, but he continued to make movies in Europe and has done until very recently. I'm not even sure when his last film was, but it not so long ago.
I
feel like I can't remember a time when I didn't know that Polanski was this kind of disgraced character. Ian, how about you? When you first saw this movie, did you know about Polanski's history?
I can't remember. I probably didn't even know who Polanski was when I first saw it.
Right, here I am again, present day Dan, with more apologies as to the sudden ending of that conversation, which was out of our hands, unfortunately. I'm sure Stella and Ian would have had other interesting things to say about that. What I will do is direct you to the episode that we did about the movie Alien Resurrection. That was myself and Ian talking about that movie. And we reflected on the problematic nature of the film's writer, Joss Whedon, who has whose reputation for general behaviour has taken a kicking in recent years, and therefore it seemed appropriate to talk about how the behaviour of a person, a creator, can affect your appreciation of their work. Just thinking about Polanski, I don't know what Stella and Ian would say, but because with me, Polanski was always a tainted creator. You know, I think before I'd seen one of his movies, I was aware that he was this kind of shunned genius, but whose body of work stood tall despite... you know, the details of his personal life. And because
Polanski has always kind of been under the shadow of those things. I don't have a problem with appreciating his work, at least in the same way that I always have done. I think it's different if the creator starts off as someone who you might personally admire and who is then tainted by actions outside of the work. So that is why my attitude to Joss Whedon, for instance, is quite different. That's the end of this episode. As I say, the Midnight Mass episode, which will again be myself and Stella and Ian, will be coming up in the near future. But next week, I will be joined by the wonderful Kirsty Warrow, film tutor and writer, to discuss one of her favourites, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, a movie that is more than 100 years old and still chilling. That will be a fascinating discussion, especially as it's a movie that I haven't watched for at least 20 years. I can't wait to revisit it. So do please join us for that. All right? Have a good week, folks. We'll be back soon. Bye-bye.
You have been listening to And Now the Podcast Starts. Produced and released by Ambidextrous Solutions Limited. Presented by Ian Winterton, Stella Gaynor, and T.D. Velasquez. Special thanks to Greg Hume for our original theme music and to Brian Gorman for our original artwork. All dialogue and music clips from films, TV shows, and trailers are used for the purposes of criticism in the spirit of fair dealing as defined in UK law and fair use as defined in US law. No copyright infringement is intended. Please visit our home on the web, www.andnowpodcast.com, for more content and contact details. Or visit our Facebook pages, at AndNowPod or at Lee Cushing Pod. Follow us on Twitter, at AndNowPodcast or at Lee Cushing Podcast. If you'd like to donate to us, please visit patreon.com/AndNowPodcast. And now, the podcast stops.